Hey, I'm Ben.
And I'm Lauren. We're both registrars working in Sydney, and we'd like to thank you for watching our first clinical examination video on the neurological examination of the upper limb.
The purpose of these videos is to help clinicians and students to perform clinical examinations that are very meaningful for the patient, because you actually elicit signs and avoid some pitfalls of junior doctors.
We hope these videos help you prepare for your OSCEs and short case examinations. If you like our videos, then please let us know what other examinations you'd like us to do and subscribe below.
The next video is going to be on the cranial nerves. We'll commence with the lower cranial nerves, which we'll define as those that arise from the pons and the medulla, but excluding the sixth cranial nerve, which of course is involved in ocular motility.
You'll find a link in the description below to a labelled picture to help you get anatomically oriented to the brainstem.
The first cranial nerve to examine in the lower cranial nerves is the fifth, which is the trigeminal nerve. There are three branches, the first of which is the ophthalmic division, second is the maxillary division, and the third is the mandibular division. These convey sensation information. The trigeminal also provides power to the masseter for chewing, and we can also investigate the jaw jerk and also the corneal reflex, which uses the fifth nerve as the afferent limb. Let's begin with sensation, and we need to test two modalities, so these are anatomically separate, the first of which is light touch. We use a cotton wool ball for this part of the examination. Lauren, can you feel when I touch you there?
Yes.
And what about over here?
Yes.
And there?
Yes.
And there?
Yes.
And there?
Yes.
And there?
Yes.
In this way, we're able to compare side to side and also between the branches. Care must be taken not to touch the angle of the jaw, as this is actually C2. And other than that, it's a simple part of the examination. Next, we move on to pinprick sensation. For this, we use our neurotips. Demonstrate to the patient first on a less sensitive area that it's a sharp stimulus, but it won't break the skin. Lauren, this is a little sharp, but it won't break the skin. Can you feel that there?
Yes.
Okay. I want you to tell me if you feel this and also if it feels sharp.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Excellent. An abnormal finding sometimes is actually hyperalgesia, where the patient experiences increased sensitivity on that side, which can suggest something such as trigeminal neuralgia. So you're looking for asymmetries and potentially less feeling or more. Now we'll move on to the motor function of the trigeminal nerve, which is for mastication, which involves the masseter and the pterygoids. Lauren, could you bite down for me and clench your jaw? Thank you very much. So you have a feel for the muscle bulk and also have a look if there's symmetry in the masseter. Now open your mouth for me and try and keep it open for me, really strong. Open, 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 really strong. Good. And you're testing the pterygoids and looking for any jaw deviation. The last thing that you check is actually a reflex looking for a pseudo bulbar type dysfunction, which would give an increased jaw jerk. We might see this in something such as motor neuron disease or advanced multiple sclerosis. Lauren, if you could just open your jaw just slightly and then keep it there just relaxed, and a little tap here on the chin. And we can see there that there's no obvious hyperactive jaw reflex, which we expect. The next nerve is the seventh cranial nerve, which is the facial nerve, which subserves the function of motor to the remainder of the face. The way we test this is here. Lauren, can I get you to close your eyes as tightly as you can and bury your eyelashes for me? Keep them closed, close, stronger, stronger. Very good. Keeping this one closed now, really strong for me, really strong, 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 strong. And you shouldn't be able to open the patient's eyes with your fingers. The next thing that we do is we look for lifting of the eyebrows. Can I get you to lift your eyebrows for me? Really high up for me, look up for me. Often looking up will get somebody to actually lift their eyebrows really strong, 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 and you're looking for any asymmetry. by trying to push down those muscles and see if you can push down the eyebrows. Here, the symmetry was preserved. Next, Lauren, I'll ask you to puff out your cheeks for me and hold some air in your mouth. Excellent. Now keep a good seal there, keep the air in there when I push. Excellent. What we're testing there is for the strength of the buccinator muscle. And it's actually quite a useful test, and you can see if somebody loses their lip seal when you push in on one side or the other. The next thing is, can I get you to show me your teeth, please? Excellent. Big smile. Fantastic. As we can see, it's very symmetrical, and we're looking at the nasolabial fold and looking for any asymmetry, and there is none there. The final muscle to test is the platysma. Often you'll have to demonstrate this for the patient. Lauren, can I get you to do this movement for me? Thank you. Symmetry is preserved. The facial nerve also conveys information of taste from the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. We won't be testing that today, but you can use a sweet or a salty solution for this purpose. The eighth nerve is the vestibulocochlear nerve. So as the name suggests, it has a vestibular component, which is important for balance, and a cochlear component, which is important for hearing. We'll commence with the vestibular component. There are a number of ways to test this. One of the most useful at the bedside is actually the head impulse test, which is often points towards a peripheral vertigo as opposed to a central. However, that's not perfect, and we use other tests to help. In the head impulse test, we move the patient's head a small amplitude, but rather quickly, and see if they can hold fixation on a single object. This suggests a peripheral pathology, if it's abnormal, on the side that you are turning to. Lauren, I'd like you to focus on one point only in the distance there. Okay. I'm going to move your head from side to side. Now, of course, when we do this in practice, you'll have to look at the patient's eyes, but for the purpose of the video, we will zoom in. This is now for the cochlear component of the eighth cranial nerve. We test hearing. This is called the whispered voice test. We have to occlude one ear over the top of the tragus of the patient while we whisper letters and numbers and see if the patient has heard what we have said. Lauren, I'd like you to repeat after me.
Okay.
I'm going to block this ear and whisper some letters and numbers.
Z53.
Excellent. This is actually a validated test with a good sensitivity and specificity for picking up hearing loss. If it's not abnormal, seldom would you proceed on to Weber's and Rinne's test, but we'll show you this for the purpose of the examination. The Weber's test is performed with a 256 Hz tuning fork. We take the tuning fork and make it resonate and place it in the midline of the patient's skull, either in the forehead or even on the top of the head. We ask them which side do they hear it on, or if it's in the middle, which is a normal answer. Lauren, can you tell me which side do you hear this on?
Middle.
Excellent. If there were abnormality, one would then proceed to the Rinne's test, or indeed we can have a symmetrical deficit. So it's good to test for the Rinne's test to look for conductive hearing loss. This is achieved by placing the tuning fork on the mastoid and then comparing it to outside the external meatus of the ear to see if the air conduction is amplifying the sound as it normally would and should. Lauren, tell me, can you hear that when I place that behind the ear?
Yes.
Tell me, is it louder when I put it there?
Yes.
Excellent. That's a normal response. The final section is the bulbar cranial nerves, which arise from the medulla, that being 9, 10, 11, and 12, glossopharyngeal, vagus, accessory, and also hypoglossal is number 12. We need to wear gloves for this part of the examination as we are coming close to the oral mucosa. What you will need is a tongue depressor, especially for people that have a Mallampati score whereby the tongue is unusually high and one can't see the uvula, and also a penlight. Lauren, can I get you to open your mouth wide for me? What I want you to do is to just say, we're just moving in there and we have a look. What we're looking for is symmetrical movement of the palate, and it's often helpful to get the patient to phonate a low frequency sound to lower the tongue. It's also important to test pharyngeal sensation if you think that there is a problem there, which can be done with a cotton bud on the posterior pharynx. However, this can induce the gag reflex, which is uncomfortable for the patient and not necessary in most instances. The next test is looking at the movement of the tongue, and the first one is actually speech. Lauren, can I get you to say the words British Constitution?
British Constitution.
And West Register Street.
West Register Street.
What we're looking for is any problems with articulation. Here we have a normal examination, of course. Now we'll look for movements of the tongue. Lauren, can you poke your tongue out for me, please? And we're looking for any deviation. Now I'd like you to push your tongue through your cheek against my fingers here. Nice and strong. Good. And now on the left side. Excellent. If there is pathology, the lesion is ipsilateral to the direction of deviation. At this point, we ask the patient to cough, as this is a good test of vagus nerve function. Lauren, if I could ask you to give us a big cough, please. As we can see, the cough had an abrupt end, which indicates that the vocal cords are adducting appropriately. This function is subserved by the recurrent laryngeal nerve branch of the vagus nerve. The last nerve to test is actually the 11th nerve, the accessory nerve, which subserves two functions. One is turning the head and the other is shrugging. Lauren, if I can get you to turn your head to the left against my hand there, nice and strong. What we're actually looking for is contraction of the sternocleidomastoid contralateral to the way we are turning. Now turn to the right for me, nice and strong. Excellent. Can I get you to shrug your shoulders up? Very good. Nice and high. Keep them up, 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 up. As we can see, symmetry is preserved. That concludes the lower cranial nerve examination.